Thank you all for being here. This is the third of four panels we're doing today here at Cleveland State University in conjunction with the Cleveland International Film Festival. I'm Kim Neuendorf. I'm a professor here. Currently, I'm the director of the Film, Television, and Interactive Media Program. A little plug for that. A major that has existed since 2005, where we, as I always like to say, training future filmmakers of America. Some of them are here today. They're also videoing, crewing this for posterity. It'll go online. And you know, I thank you, all of you, for agreeing to do this. Today, our topic now is the documentary present and future. I teach documentary at Cleveland State University, so I'll try not to put too many of my own questions out there. I have some basic questions I'm going to ask, but then we're going to open it up for Q&A from the audience. But some of the questions might be, you know, I'm a documentary nerd, so, you know, I might be throwing out maybe too many questions. Yes, thank you. We're going to go down the line and introduce our esteemed panelists. I have bios for each of them that I will read, and then we'll ask each of them maybe to talk a little bit about what film they are representing here at the Cleveland International Film Festival. All of our panelists have a strong background across film, with a lot of experience in films prior to the one that they're showing at the Cleveland International Film Festival. Let's start with Philip. Philip Dolin is, yeah, you get selected images from the students up there.
Oh my God.
My student staff. I'm going to read a bio. Philip has over 25 years of combined experience in filmmaking, producing, advertising, and marketing. As a producer, he created short films, commercials, and over 65 hip-hop music videos for such artists as Salt and Peppa, Kid and Play, and MC Light. He received an MFA in film from Columbia University and directed and produced a feature film, B-Movie, that played at festivals in Europe and the U.S. In the world of advertising, he was a vice president, senior copywriter at Wonderman, one of the world's largest direct marketing agencies.
Where did you get this bio? That's
okay.
You can just stop.
Should I stop now?
Yeah, I think that's fine.
Okay. No. You were in South America as a Fulbright scholar.
Yeah.
All right?
Yes.
My students do their research, okay?
Let them follow up if they're interested.
Okay. All right. And he's representing at this festival an art that nature makes, the work of Rosalind Purcell. Let me introduce each person, then we'll go back to the beginning and ask you to talk about your film. Next on tap, we have Brian. Right, there he is.
Hey,
Brian Arriotti.
Okay.
Representing God Knows Where I Am.
I'm an actor. It's my headshot. So sorry.
And your girlfriend. Brian is a documentary editor and producer whose film credits include Delta Boys in 2012, Medina's Dream, 2014, The Home Front, 2015, and Nehru, winner of the 2015 Sundance Audience Award. He began his career in 2007 as an intern for Nickelodeon and has gone on to work for MTV, get ready, NBC, Sci-Fi Channel, AMC, The Onion, Vogue, HGTV, The Food Network, Bravo, VH1, Logo, Overture Films, and National Geographic. Next on tap, we have, get ready.
Oh, they found that one. Yeah. Oh, great.
We have Ryan, and I always get it wrong. Ryan Levy or Levy?
Levy.
Levy. I see. I always say Levy, and I'm wrong.
15 years.
Right? I know. After 15 years, you think I get it right. Ryan Bruce Levy is president of Ryan Bruce Levy Film Distribution and PR Services in Toronto, Canada. It's a multi-pronged film marketing, distribution, and PR firm with specialty in LGBT and documentary cinema. Mr. Levy has spearheaded Canadian and North American campaigns for such films as The Invisible War, We Were Here, Matt Shepard is a Friend of Mine, we might remember that from CIFF 2 years ago, Drone, Sleepless in New York, and The Creeping Garden. Ryan's clients have included documentary master Frederick Wiseman, my students should know who that is, Oscar winner Charmaine Obaid-Chinoy, documentary legend Steve James, award-winning animator Bill Plimpton, and Oscar nominee Tony-winning powerhouse Julie Taymor. Next we have Lisa Klein. Lisa, beyond laughter, Laughter and Tears is the film that she co-directed and is presenting at CIFF. She is one of the founders of Mad Picks Incorporated, an independent production company with a commitment to make documentary films that affect social change. She and co-director Doug Blush, who's sitting in the second row, are the creative team behind the critically acclaimed feature documentary Of Two Minds, which takes a compelling look at the extraordinary lives of people living, struggling, and triumphing with bipolar disorder. Of Two Minds won a SAMHSA, Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration Voice Award, and an EIC, Entertainment Industry Council PRISM Award, both of which honor filmmakers for their authentic storytelling of mental illness and substance abuse issues. She is currently in production on The S Word, a film providing a window into the lives of those surviving and thriving beyond their suicide attempts. She resides in Los Angeles, California, with her husband and film partner, Doug, and their daughter, Madeline, or Madeline?
Madeline,
thank you. All right, welcome. And next, to the big panel, John Ritchie began his film career after graduating in 2003 from the University of New Orleans. In 2007, he began his own production company, Scrub Brush Productions, producing many music videos and short narrative and documentary films. After teaching documentary classes to teenagers in the New Orleans public schools, John began work on Shell Shocked in 2008, releasing it in 2013. Shell Shocked has screened across several communities across the U.S., won many awards at film festivals, played on PBS, screened at the NLC's Annual Congress of Cities and Expositions in Seattle, and get ready for this one, the only film shown at the Dalai Lama's convention in New Orleans in 2013. John recently completed work on 91%, the film that he's presenting at CIFF, a film about gun policy in the United States with a focus on background checks. He's currently working on a film about women's thyroid health. Finally, we have Arno Harris, who has worked as a 3D director and stereographer on a variety of formats, including documentaries, music videos, commercials, and short films. Some of his recent 3D work includes The Land of the Bears, a feature documentary co-produced by James Cameron about grizzly bears in Kamchatka. Arno filmed major monuments around the world, among others the Temple of Songwangsa in South Korea, the Sistine Chapel in Rome, and Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. He also participated in Michel Conte's feature film art project, The Girl from Nagasaki, an official selection for the Sundance Film Festival in 2014. And he recently directed a feature documentary about the artists of the Burning Man Festival, which is The Art of Burning, presented at CIFF this year. Welcome to our panelists. Let's give them a round of applause. Now you get to speak, please. And we'll go down the line just briefly. We'll open it up, you know, later. It's not always going to be like this, but please tell me about this film and anything else you want us to know about yourself.
All right. Well, this film is called An Art That Nature Makes, the work of Rosamund Purcell. It's about a photographer, and we tend to do a lot of films about the creative process and art, and my partner, Amalie Bernstein, we made a film about a magician named Ricky Jay called Deceptive Practice, and through that, we met this photographer, Rosamund Purcell, and we're very attracted to her work, and we just started making a film about her, and actually it was going to be a short film, and then the interviews got very interesting, and we just decided to expand it, and we didn't really think about what the reception would be at all, so we've been really pleasantly surprised at how popular it's been, how much people have enjoyed it.
our film is God Knows Where I Am. It's about a well-educated mother in New Hampshire who develops bipolar schizophrenia late in her life, ends up in a hospital. She discharges herself. The family isn't notified because of patient confidentiality and HIPAA laws. And she ends up breaking into an abandoned farmhouse where she lives off of rainwater and apples for 3 months. Documents her delusional journey for this time and ultimately ends up starving to death and dying in there. We speak with the sister and the daughter and basically try to bring her journal to life through her own words.
So I'm Ryan Levy, film distributor, publicist, been a programmer for festivals.
I'm also a filmmaker as well. I have the opportunity right now to be currently working with the team from God Knows Where I Am. I've had a wonderful opportunity to handle theatrical distribution in Canada for Lisa and Doug's previous feature, Of Two Minds. So I'm really excited to be back. I've been coming to the festival for 18 years, so this is really a lovely opportunity to speak further about what's happened, because in 18 years this industry has completely turned on its head and continues to do so every time. So.
And I'm sorry, the bio that we put together did not include your own documentary work.
Yes.
Could you mention that briefly?
Yes, I had a film here in 2013 called The Closest Thing to Heaven, and my newest documentary, Nora Through the Years, just world premiered 3 weeks ago at Cinequest, and I'm working on a feature documentary on million record-selling Christian music artists who, at the height of their careers, came out of the closet and were completely exiled from their faith-based music community, and how they've had to reinvent and rediscover their careers without that support system.
Okay, so I'm Lisa Klein, and the film that we have here, I co-directed with Doug. It's called Beyond Laughter and Tears, and they came to us to, apparently we're sort of the brain people, because we did Of Two Minds about bipolar disorder, and I'm doing something on suicide. Not brain as in smart, brain as in neurological conditions, I guess. So what happened? Okay, so they came to us because there's this condition called PBA, pseudobulbar affect, which I'm sure everybody has heard of and can tell me more about than I know. And they're like, hey, you want to do this movie on this? I'm like, I've never heard of it. And we started researching it, and the point of making the movie was, I'll tell you what it is in a second, was to raise awareness, because people hadn't heard of it. And what it is, it's a condition that stems from other conditions like traumatic brain injuries and strokes or MS or dementia. And the affect is extreme laughing or crying, not necessarily based on what's going on. So, for example, we have somebody in the movie who laughed uncontrollably at his mother's funeral. So you can understand the discomfort with that. So we thought it seemed like something that people should know about, because there are probably a lot of people running around with this and having no idea why they're doing it. So that's why we're making, why we did this movie.
Okay. My name is John Ritchie, and the film that I'm representing is called 91%, and 91% is about gun policies in the U.S. with a focus on background checks. And the reason that the film is called 91% is because it's named after a poll that came out shortly after Sandy Hook that showed that 91% of Americans were for background checks on all gun sales. And even with a overwhelming approval rating or a mandate like that, Congress still doesn't pass a universal background check. And so we do look at a little bit of like a brief history about the current history of the background check, explaining where the loophole is, and what's happened as far as on the federal level, which is pretty much nothing. And then we quickly go into stories about people from across the country that have been affected by shootings that the guns that were used in the shootings were obtained without a background check. And so then our characters, like a lot of people who have been affected by shootings, they've all turned to activism in order to kind of deal with this trauma that they have. And so it just kind of follows them as far as like with the frustrations of dealing with Congress, and then looking at what movement has happened with it over the last couple months and where we are right now. So.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Arno Paris. I did a documentary on Burning Man, which I'm sure some of you know it more as a, you know, like a drug and a party festival in the Nevada desert. But the truth is that it started as an art festival, and it's kind of like been losing its soul over the years. And yet we have incredible artists that go with amazing dedication to make beautiful art, and so we wanted to make that movie about their work and their dedication and give back, you know, like what they deserve, which is not necessarily that something that the festival is giving them.
Okay, thank you all. As I said, I teach here, and so some of my questions may relate to that. This is just the one question I'd like to ask filmmakers, because I teach documentary filmmaking, but I also teach film history. Who would you say out of film history has influenced you the most as a filmmaker, or a certain type of film, or a particular film? Is there any through line? Is there anyone who has influenced you in particular, or who do you admire, even if it doesn't reflect in your work? Throw it out, anyone.
Mel Brooks.
That's good.
That kid just zopped up.
Werner Herzog.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Charlie Chaplin.
All right. Well, can you explain a little bit?
Well, I remember once there was a weekend when I watched a huge number of movies of all different kinds, including Charlie Chaplin film. And at the end of the weekend, it just stood out as the best in my mind. Just the ability to communicate in a simple way. And,
okay.
And the ability to bring his own personal experience to the story, and so on.
Yeah.
Just and also silent film being kind of an art that people don't appreciate so much, as an incredibly well developed way of telling stories.
Mm-hmm. So. But you can still tell stories that way today, though, right? Or
yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true. I mean, there's a lot going on in filmmaking besides the dialogue, that's mm-hmm. for sure.
Right. You said Werner Herzog, and what about Werner Herzog, besides his incredible voiceovers?
Right, I like how he was able to kind of like give a new era to documentary filmmaking, in a sense, because a lot of people think of him as trying to make a starification of, you know, documentary filmmakers by putting the documentary filmmaker kind of like at the center of the documentary, but I think he was actually trying to bring a different approach, in the sense that, you know, he was breaking the barrier between mockumentary, documentary, and fiction. And I think it was a very interesting, you know, way to explore where we could push documentaries, especially as they're getting more, they're getting more exposure in the film world, and you see more documentaries in the theater. So that was, I think, very, very inspiring for me.
Anyone else?
You know, I was thinking about it, and at first I was like, oh God, who would I say, you know, but because they just never really thought about it. But the way that I would say, actually, in a very literal sense, I like Spike Lee, because the first documentary that I ever worked on was When the Levees Broke. I come from working as far as, like, I graduated from film school, and I did narrative films, like, as far as, like, you know, as a crew member, as a camera assistant. And so after, you know, I live in New Orleans, and so after Katrina, when he did When the Levees Broke, that was the first film that I worked on, and you know, I think that it was from that, like, as far as spending 9 months working on that and listening to all these interviews and really getting an understanding as far as, like, what happened, much more than you would ever do, like, as far as, like, if you were just to read the papers, you know, I really started to like documentaries, and so that's how I got into the documentaries.
The reason I said Mel Brooks, actually the reason I said it came off the top of my head, but now I've had a little time to think about it, so I'm going to back up what my reason is that, because the laughter for sure, but being able to take a subject, I mean, Springtime for Hitler, for example. So you have something and you're dealing with Nazis and stuff, and most people, I would imagine, are not huge Nazi fans, but to be able to laugh at that, and we're doing a film on suicide right now, and that's, you know, that's a documentary that we're doing, and when I tell people, we're, you know, they ask what we're doing a film on suicide, like, you know, and it's met with that, but it doesn't, it just, like, if you say Nazis, it's like, you know, but it doesn't have to be, and to make it palatable, and to tell stories, and to do it through humor and everything else, I just think that is the key to relating.
That's fantastic. Thanks. Anyone else, or anyone
want to start? I mean, I've had a great opportunity to work with Frederick Wiseman, who for me just, you know, embodies such, you know, passion. And I think what's most amazing about Fred is that he's maintained this kind of purity through his work. He doesn't compromise. I watched him sit at a panel this year for the very first time. A man who's made 50 films at 85 years of age has got to sit in a room and justify why he needs money from people in Europe. And they asked him why he couldn't make a film that was palatable to what their broadcast needs were. And he said, well, I'm 85 years old, I've made 50 films, I've been broadcast all over the world, and just because you can't wrap your head around how to broadcast my movies in Europe doesn't mean I'm going to compromise. And then he said, my films are 4 hours for a reason. My subjects are important to me, and they deserve the time and care that I feel I need to give them. And that's how he does that. So for me, stylistically, for what I make, I don't make a Wiseman film. I don't know if I could be that patient. I mean, he shoots 300 hours to cut to 4. And Fred's finishing his new feature right now. He's 85. He's starting production on 2 more that'll come out each year, and he just keeps going. And we're just about to get to the 50th anniversary of Titty Cut Follies. So for me, Fred Wiseman carries weight. I think of neorealist cinema from countries that you wouldn't necessarily think of. People like Lino Broja in the Philippines just carry so much. Usman Sembene in Senegal. These filmmakers inspire me because they're taking their indigenous stories and creating a world. Lav Diaz is a wonderful ethnographic Filipino filmmaker, makes 14-hour masterpieces that I can't turn away from. So those kind of stories that are rooted in truth, honesty, and have that really, or just that genuine warmth and heart and truth to them, whether fiction or nonfiction, resonate deeply with me.
Well, that was a great answer.
I agree.
For me, it's kind of cliche. I'm sure a lot of people have this one, but Stanley Kubrick really, really influenced me. When I was 9 years old, I found a VHS tape in my dad's room of a Clockwork Orange. I don't think any 9-year-old in retrospect should watch a Clockwork Orange, but watch that, and my head exploded, and then I just had to get my hands on everything. I watched 2001, and I'd never seen pacing like that in a film before, or characters, or that kind of tone. I just didn't know what I was watching, but I just couldn't get enough of it. So it was really the first time I kind of wrapped my head around a director having the ability to set a tone and style, and having that power, and having all his films be instantly recognizable frame by frame.
And studied literally frame by frame.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Great answers, you guys. Thank you. Thank you. Moving on to, I have reenactments on my list. You know, that's kind of the trite question we must ask, the trend toward reenactments. Once upon a time, audience, you could not have a reenactment in a documentary and have it called a documentary. Even though people like Flaherty had reenacted things as far back as Nanook of the North, it wasn't acceptable until Errol Morris, Thin Blue Line, and other filmmakers. And I think it's been kind of a trend toward more and more the ability to use more reenactments. Can we maybe address that? But also, feel free to move on to other, what are some critical changing issues? I mean, you said, Ryan, that in 18 years things have changed tremendously.
Well, I mean, the first is just projection formats start
right.
And what we're shooting on. I mean, everything, you know, the digital advent has, for, you know, in good and bad, has put the tools and made it easier for all of us, I think, to make work and distribute work and present work. But in that also comes a handful of incredible problems where we've managed to put tools into a lot of people who have a lot of money and too much spare time to make very bad, 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 bad work. And it certainly is a struggle for me to go through that work because I constantly am being bombarded with this amount of work. Film festivals, anybody now thinks they can start a film festival. There are some that are very great, like this one. Cleveland's an incredible film festival, but I live in a city where there's 190 film festivals.
Are
you
serious?
Do I really need 190 film festivals? You know, Estonia had a good year in 2005 and 3 films came out, and now I've got a bloody Estonian film festival that happens, and it's just like there's not enough work coming out of that country, and it actually dilutes and hurts film and filmmakers, and we want to be shown in the best possible places. We don't want to show up where nobody is seeing our films. We want to make sure that we're also, and the other problem now is that filmmakers, all of these people here, are now being asked by these filmmakers to give content for free. And I'm of the belief that a film festival, if they're charging a ticket, should be paying for content. And we don't create free content for you. And the only way we can continue to create and tell our stories is if we're monetizing. So that's a big issue. Mm-hmm. It's exhibition opportunities, the windows are closing. So film festivals are taking the space where our theatrical windows are. Netflix is wonderful, we're not all gonna get on there. We also realize we need a theatrical venue to get reviews, and that's what moves us up the ladder, because Netflix is the new video store of the 80s. There's now 30, 40,000 films there, and when you used to walk through the shelves and pull a tape, you often didn't know that film, but when that marketing campaign on that box it said, whatever year's theatrical release, there was quotes in that. So we all have to figure out how this is changing. We have to constantly be researching, and if I can say one thing that's the most important, there's no excuse not to know what's going on in this industry. All of that information is at your fingertips, and if you're too bloody lazy to research it, when anything goes wrong with your film and when you get it out there, it's your own fault. I can't stress that enough.
Ryan, what do you really think? This is why we love Ryan. Ryan's been on our panels on and off, not every year, but you've been on three, four times.
It's been a couple years.
Yeah, it's been quite a while. Welcome back. Welcome back, Ryan. We enjoy your perspective. Other folks, be it reenactments or what other, you know, things, both in terms of technique or distribution, as Ryan was talking about, what is changing? Because our topic really is the documentary present and future. So what's going on, what's changing, what are the critical issues that we're dealing with as we move forward?
With our film, we kind of ran into a roadblock early on because we were hesitant to do any kind of reenactment thing, but our main character in our film had died prior to us starting filming, so we kind of had this void. How do we tell this woman's story without actually having her there? So what we did have was a journal where she detailed every hour, every thought she had into this book. So basically, we made the decision, we were torn, do we put text on a screen and have you just sit there reading for 2 hours, which we thought would be a nightmare for everybody, or do we bring on an actress to kind of perform it? And then how do we do that? Do we ever act it up? Do we have just a cold, dry reading of someone reading a book to you? So we brought on Lori Singer, who's like the lead actress from Footloose, Side Kevin Bacon, and she took it to heart. She started method acting. She locked herself in a closet for 3 days, starved herself to really prepare for the role, and then just did this amazing reading right into her iPhone. We're gonna bring her into the studio and kind of have this artificial, perfectly sounding recording. But what she did on her iPhone was just so perfect because she became this character. So fortunately, we're able to avoid kind of having an actual actress on screen reenacting every single thing. And we really tried to have our cameras be our character. So we use cinematography. We use 35 millimeter film, 16, Super 16, basically to just have you as an audience see what she would have seen in conjunction with the voiceover from Lori. So I think reenactments, though, is a really fine line in documentary, but I think it can be an aid if it's done. And I hope we did. I think we did do it in a delicate way.
Anyone else
want to
chime in?
Fantastic. Well, there's so many different kinds of films, and they can mean so many different things to people. Ours was different in that it was a photographer about a photographer's life, so we used all of her images, and we used photographs that her husband had taken, and we used videos that they had shot 20 years ago, so it was kind of the opposite of the enactment. But you've got to put something on the screen, so if the event happened, as in your case, you have to figure out some way to have an image on the screen. So I think it's great. I think anything works as long as it's done with delicacy and with good taste and so forth.
I've never personally dealt with reenactments, but like last night, we were falling asleep. We were watching the History Channel, and they decided to play on the OJ thing. So there was this documentary on OJ, and because Nicole Simpson is not alive as a result of possibly OJ, they used her, they were reading her journals, and they had an actress do her voice. It was ridiculous. It was ridiculous. Like, it could have been, and as we were watching, it's like, first of all, it sounded like, what, would you say Betty Boop? I don't know what the voice, I don't know what, no, because there was some recording of Nicole. I mean, there's recording, because they had video and stuff like that, and plus you hear her 911 call, and this sounded nothing like her voice. It was just weird. So it was like a weird thing, and it took us right out of it. You know, so that can happen.
So even, would you say, because the reason I brought this up is this is a tool that was introduced really and became acceptable about 25 years ago. And that, to me, it seems to be used more and more, and maybe badly, but people are more free to use any kind of reenactment. It's a good tool, as you were saying, Philip, when used well, effectively,
right.
But it's a very dangerous...
it is. It can just suck you right out of whatever.
And that's what you don't want in any documentary. You want people to be in that moment.
Right, because that's what it's all about.
Yeah. Anyone else?
I mean, the only time that I've used it very minimally, and whatever I do, it's to where it's seamless, like insert shots or stuff like that, to where there's no way that anybody would necessarily know that this is a reenactment. You know, we don't claim that it's the real, I mean, you know, you just don't say it, and usually it just comes off as seamless, you know? Like I said, we've done in both my films, I think we did it one time in each one, and it really was just in order to be able to cover and edit point to where we really didn't have a choice to. But you know, one of the things I was thinking about while you were asking that question is that I've noticed that as far as like now that you can find all this footage online, you know, that the access to archival footage and B-roll, there's a lot of stuff out there that you would never be able to get your hands on. And I have friends that have made documentaries based off of just that new access to document. Like there's like people like music artists that people thought there was no existing footage of at all, and then you go onto YouTube and all of a sudden you find hours and hours of this person that they thought there wasn't anything of. So,
Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah. No need to invent visuals when you can collect so many of these.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
In their archive.
Yeah.
I guess we've been sort of been going up and down the line, Arno.
I'm not very familiar with reenactment.
Well, good.
it's a tough one. I would definitely be thinking hardly about it, you know, before doing it. So.
Well, it's used a lot, right, you guys? And it's not necessarily by present company then. And I didn't want to get stuck on just that. What are some other important trends in documentary filmmaking that go ahead.
On this one I can talk because we shot the documentary on Burning Man in 3D, so we had two cameras, you know, filming the left eye and the right eye, and I would say it did help also the documentary just because from a distribution standpoint, there are a lot of theaters that have been converted to digital, and a lot of them went the 3D way, and yet there is not that much compelling 3D content. I mean, there is a lot of fiction, but as far as documentary, because it's so hard to film in 3D, there is not so much content in 3D, so I would say for filmmakers, it's actually helped us a lot to be able to, you know, like push the movie out there in the distribution, theatrical distribution, which some of the movies I worked on would not necessarily have made it to the big screen if it was just in 2D. So it is helping from a distribution standpoint.
How does it help tell your story?
Well, that's a different thing. I wouldn't say all of these documentaries, like it wasn't justified for all these documentaries to be in 3D. As far as our documentary, the one on Burning Man, because it's such a difficult place to go to, it's just like, you know, this crazy place, you have to pay a lot of money to go there, it's terrible living conditions for a week, you're just living in the desert and sandstorms and stuff like that. So a lot of the people that are interested into the festival but don't necessarily want to go through the trouble of being there were able to experience that to some extent, because the 3D was bringing a feeling of immersion, with, you know, like depicting the art in a very specific way. You could almost see that you would see more than the people that were at Burning Man, also because we were like capturing it from aerial perspectives. So yeah, it was bringing a lot. I would say that 3D really helps. I've shot a lot of monuments and places. 3D helps a lot on the architectural standpoint to, you know, like show the magnificence of some places or some pieces of art.
But would you say 3D is not necessary for all film or all documentaries? Certainly, sometimes we may not want to be immersed.
Definitely not.
You know, like OJ. Yeah. You want that. Good, great. Yeah, so you are going to do more 3D
Actually, no.
Docs?
I mean, when the topic, you know, justifies it, yes. But yeah. I've been also looking into virtual reality. I think it's something that documentary filmmakers should definitely look into, because it's when, you know, you put on the glasses and you're able to turn around, like you turn around yourself 360 degree, and you can see the world all around yourself. And there has been a lot of talks of how it's kind of like possibly bringing a new era into filmmaking, but I personally think it's more for journalism and documentary that's going to be the most useful, because it's a great way to bring the audience even closer and inside of the topic that you're trying to document. So it's very strange, because you don't shoot at all like you used to shoot, but it's a very, very interesting form of documentary narrative to explore.
Just an aside, the festival is completely embracing that here. They have this perspectives component that's here that's actually exploring some of the VR, so I highly recommend people get down to Tower City and check that out. It's exploring some other wonderful things. A friend of mine, Brett Gaylor, has a piece in there, and his previous film was a film called Rip, a Remix Manifesto, and they actually made a component of that film where you could take his content and re-edit it and recreate it as your own. It asks a lot of questions around copyright and Creative Commons and fair use, but to what Arno said about virtual reality, I couldn't agree more. It's definitely going to be something that's explored, and I highly recommend everybody go and check out that exhibition that the festival has on.
Can I bring something up since we're talking about this? That is, only until a certain amount of hours. If you want to do that, and you've got nothing to do, go immediately after this. They close very, very soon.
7, and they're open tomorrow as well.
7 p.m. and tomorrow noon to 5. And what this is an installation in Tower City, not in the theater area.
On the second floor.
Second floor of Tower City. It's a VR installation. Is it free, or does it cost?
Yes, it's free.
I thought it was. Yeah, so you don't have to go into the film festival to pay admission. Thanks for pointing that out. Yep.
Something, I don't know if it's a trend, but I think it's more of a necessity for I mean, I think I can't speak for everybody here, but if you ask people why they go into documentary, I think there are a lot of reasons. The one that I usually don't hear is for the money. So, you know, in our case, it's sort of, you know, it's like, you know, finding funding and, oh, we're doing the suicide film. And what we're finding, which is great, it's like as far as the cinematography goes, as far as that goes, to give people in the film cameras, because it's a very intimate piece, it's very much a character piece, and there are people who, whether you're going through severe depression or you're thinking about, if they have a camera themselves and they're talking and we're not there, it's different when we're there. I mean, again, we build relationships and we want them to tell us everything. But there are times, A, that we're not there, and B, that they really just need to talk and they have this camera right in front of them. So something about just making sure that everybody has a way that they can, you know. So what that does for the film, where you have a film where everything is beautifully, perfectly shot, using the C300 or whatever the camera is at all times, and it's uniform, that's one approach, and ours is kind of the opposite. I mean, I can't tell you how many cameras are in it. It's necessity. Sometimes it's a cell phone, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, again, I don't know if it's a trend or not, but it's something that, you know, we've kind of had to do.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe a trend toward, which includes the reenactments, a trend toward a bigger toolbox.
Right.
For a whole bunch of things.
Right.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt.
To go?
I'm
going to
take
that's
Brian
soon.
Out to
yeah.
get back to a Q&A.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's
I'm staying.
You're staying?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
Yeah, so I'm going to do Q&A for my film.
Right. Yeah.
When is it screening?
It's screening today, right now. If anyone wants to come to Q&A, you can join.
I saw most of it.
Oh, did you?
And I did have a question for you, but
you can ask it as I.
Well, usually,
I just wanted to say it was really well done.
Oh, thanks so much. That's great.
Yeah, yeah, enough. I saw it too.
If you can say a few words on it, or
yeah,
you ask it just a few more minutes. To do so,
like, or we could just go. You have to go
No, usually, yeah, he gives us a heads up.
Yeah, oh, you in over there, please.
How did it come to you or made you decide to do that? You weren't doing it before she died,
right?
It came to you afterwards.
Right.
And then what is it that led you to select that and then...
Yeah, so actually, Linda at that point was completely off the radar, so no one knew what she was doing during that stretch until her journal was found beside her body in this house. There was a article written in the local Concord Monitor, a very small paper, just a paragraph basically mentioning that a woman had died alone in a farmhouse around some apple cores in a journal. It was picked up by the New Yorker, by wonderful young writer Rachel Aviv, who wrote like this beautiful piece, also called God Knows Where I Am. You can look it up online. Very well written, just kind of getting into the issues of mental health and Linda's story as the showcase. Todd and Jed Wider, who are the two directors on this, were wanting to do a story on the homeless, wanting to do a story on the mentally ill. We all live in New York City, so we've been experiencing a lot of that all around us, and they came across the New York article and was like, this covers all our bases, homelessness, mental illness, so just the perfect launching pad to kind of go off of that and take on this bigger story, just focusing on this one woman.
Well, you have to go now.
Okay, good. Thanks so much.
Brian.
That would
be Brian.
Yeah, you can be Brian now, right?
No, I wanted to be Lisa.
You want to be
I
Lisa?
Said
okay. I'm going to open up to Q&A in just a moment. I just have to ask this one, given, you know, we're talking about the future a little bit. Whether we like it or not, and I guess I would ask you, do you like it? Over this last 6 months or so, some things have changed. There was a big hit on Netflix. There was a docu-series called The Making of a Murder. And that kind of hit audiences and, so hard. So many people. How many people watched The Making of a Murder? At least part of it. Not the majority. The majority of my students have, but still a huge. Given the fragmented audiences we have today, a huge audience for that. And on the heels of that, a number of people I know who have done true crime documentaries or docu-series have been, you know, approached to make more of this kind of content. Do you think that, what impact do you think this has, both in terms of the type of content, the true crime suddenly being, you know, more popular once again, and also the notion of the docu-series being highly popular?
Docu-series, that sounds great. I'd love to do one. I don't know. We tend to avoid murder and serial killers in both our work and things we watch, but that's just us. But we didn't see that, but I think it's great. I mean, I think yeah. People get excited about film and I don't think there's a problem with it.
I mean, I certainly was captivated by it. I think it's a great series. I mean, the idea to have a longer, a larger opportunity to tell a story and go even that more in depth is wonderful. Some people don't necessarily have that attention span to watch, you know, a series that long. But the true crime film and that documentary genre has been popular for years and years. I mean, my parents, are obsessed with that. I mean, I go home to visit them, and if I'm sitting in the living room, just kind of off to the side doing my own thing, they're binge watching like 48 Hours murder mystery. I mean, they literally tape it. So there's a definite interest in it. it's not necessarily somewhere I want to go, but I'm quite fascinated by it. But again, there's some really terrible content out there, and I would contend that most of that right. 48 hours of very formula. What was refreshing about Making of a Murderer is the technical skill and the quality of filmmaking was head and shoulders above what we've seen before. So for film fans, that series was satiating an interest in that topic where a lot of people probably turned away because there is this constant tabloid formula for telling these stories with those kind of news outlet documentary series.
So we open up for questions, though, and get back more specifically to ask these folks about their films, their perspectives on filmmaking. Does anyone have questions? In the back, first.
When you're doing a film and you're targeting, let's say, a family or someone who's went through a challenging situation, and dealing with compensation in terms of what should be a fair compensation to them, with the understanding that, as an independent filmmaker, with understanding that the film may not get broad circulation, how would you navigate that conversation?
That's really a complicated question. I mean, it's constantly changing. I mean, it used to be you couldn't pay people to be in films. That was like against the kind of ethical approach.
It's not still like that?
Yeah. I bet any combination happens depending on the situation. Yeah. I don't know.
I know that still a lot of grant applications will kind of like, they allude to the fact that they do not want you to, they don't want, or to be funded or in turn the other way too, like as far as, I've in situations where I've been approached maybe a couple times asking if there was any compensation for interviews, I politely tell them that's not really how documentaries work. But, in the cases where there's someone that has, like, special needs, or if there's somebody, like one of the characters in my film, because of being shot, has enormous medical bills. I mean, like medication, her monthly medication, is astronomical as much as it costs, and she can't work. And so, the thing is that we think about doing things like, for instance, trying to use the film to maybe like help her raise money in order to cover some of those costs. But like, we can't promise anything up front or anything like that, or pay out of pocket,
So I guess the follow up, so do you get a lot of pushback then from that, or I guess in time you learn how to navigate through that?
It's called trust. It really is. I think we have to take the time to build our trust. Mm-hmm. As filmmakers, this is the key, is you have to show them, whether that's showing previous work, whether that's sitting with them and caring and sharing their story and getting to know them, whether that's talking to their friends and their family. When you get to that point, that's what gets you that story. That's what breaks that third wall. That's what gets us through. I mean, I've had the great pleasure of working with Doug and Lisa on Of Two Minds, and I know, and with their new film, the level of intimacy and the level of trust that you have to have with those subjects is key. And I deal with it when I'm even reaching out to them and doing outreach campaigns for films. When we're dealing with issues around mental illness, when we're dealing with issues around gun violence, and even somebody's personal artistic pieces, this is about trust. And it's about making sure and proving to them that you're going to tell their story and you are putting their lives in your hands. And that's a big, big gift. And when you do that, you will get them to give you everything you need and more. And the gift at the end of that is their story and something that they always have. And then that, hopefully, that film will allow them the opportunity to benefit and grow and reap any rewards.
I mean, this is something everyone talks about technology, which is amazing, but relationships is so important. I mean, and that's something that's not so discussed so much, and it's very personal, and that's kind of the art of creating that stories. You need that relationship. Yeah. But I'd be interested to know how you define documentary in your class. if you pay somebody, it's not really a documentary. It's probably like at that point, it's a fiction film.
Interesting, right? You know, class members scattered around. Well, we struggle with what is the definition of documentary. And on a panel like this before, I've done that.
Rules.
How do you define a documentary? And there are so many different definitions. And to me, that's what also has changed over the past 20 or 25 years is all kinds of, the boundaries have gotten blurrier. There are all kinds of ways that you can define it. And I think you're right, though. I think, you know, that's a great point, that if it is bought and paid for, if it's not a sharing of a story, then it's your film, you know, Philip Dolin. It's your film, but it's Rosamund Purcell's story.
Well, yeah, and there's something about teasing out the story. The generosity is a big part of it, I think. You're teasing out the story, and then you're presenting something, and you often surprise the person, they don't know what you're doing, what to expect, and mm-hmm.
Yeah, because that's the thing. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go on. No, but I can understand how it's kind of. Well, you know. It's kind of funny, people might expect to be paid if they're putting in time, but it's just one of those things that
but
doesn't,
then, no,
it's beyond
right,
that.
But then it's paid for, as opposed to you building a relationship and telling their story through you.
Well, it's like saying, I want to paint a portrait of you, would you sit for my portrait?
Yeah.
What are you paying me? I'm not paying you, but I'm going to give you a portrait of yourself. I'm going to capture you, and it's going to help me, and hopefully you'll enjoy it as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and like, both said yes, it's definitely about trust and it's about respect and all of that. And then the idea when you're with somebody, if you're filming with somebody for like a full day, you know, it just sort of general like kindness stuff, like you buy them lunch or you buy them dinner or you know because they're with you and you're doing that kind of thing. But if you, the only time that we ever came into, it's never come up except for once, and that's on the film that we're showing here, when a doctor, it came through, it's like, yes, I'm used to doing this stuff, and I get paid when I do it, and our response was, but then you don't have to do this, we don't need, you know, in a nice way, it's not like, yeah, we don't need you, it's just like, well, it just isn't what we do, and because also with money comes, when you talk about making a murder or whatever, I mean, you can manipulate anything. And you're saying, like, you're sitting for a portrait and you're a fly on the wall, you often a fly on the wall, and these people are telling their stories, but you have editors. And editors can do amazing things, and that's what makes it the filmmaker's story. And so that becomes a really interesting balance, too. And you,
I mean, and I've certainly encountered it. I worked on a film with a rather unscrupulous filmmaker. I don't care if I name him at all.
He's right there in the second row.
So says his wife. and he made a film on animal rights, and he was taking the position of the Animal Liberation Front and wanting to present kind of a straight down the line, give both sides an opportunity, but where the line of ethics was completely blown apart was he had gone to the anti-animal rights group and said, I want to make a film that trashes the animal rights activist movement. And he got $500,000 from them, and he made the film he wanted to make, but he lied to them and told them, and then they started coming to screenings, they would show up, they would fly all over the world. And ultimately, I had a situation where the film was pulled out of a bunch of theaters in the morning because they faxed movie theaters directly paperwork. That's a problem. That's a problem because he took money from somebody, said, I want to make the film, he got the funding, and he bold-faced lied. That's not trust. And I don't care whether you believe in what they're saying or they're not. If I make a film about gay rights, and I go to the people who hate me and say, I'm going to make a film that trashes the gay community, then I'm scum. Because that's not trust. That's not ethics. We shouldn't be giving money to people. This is about building these relationships and getting the most honest and truthful story. And if you approach this with trust, love, respect, dignity, and honesty, you will get that and more, and your work will resonate, and you will.
Well, there's a definite. But that's
I was going to say that sounds like a good topic for a film. Following this guy lying.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Going to the people.
Yeah, I guess I'm a subject in it because he screwed me out of $100,000 too.
Let's get some other questions over against the wall.
There's a variety of movies here, but the one general theme that I see is how do you capture, there's a lot of work with the mind. How do you capture the difference of creativity or mental health or illness and put that on film? Because it's such a delicate interior thing for any person, but you're trying to extract that and put that on and make a narrative out of it.
I think everybody has a different filmmaking style and a way they approach their stories. You can approach it the way that Brian and Todd and Jed did, which was have these diaries and do this very elegical, gentle, artistic film. You can do the intimate interviews that Lisa's film does, where they're dealing with the families and getting personal and presenting those observations around, you know, what's happening with them with PBA and when they're laughing and they're crying. And then you can do what John did beautifully, and I unfortunately haven't seen your film yet, and your film as well, where they're dealing with these emotional stories of loss and the fallout around the psychology. Everybody's got a different style. Everybody creates a different body of work. There's no tried and true style. There's no tried and true rule. I think the only key is that we come to this, if we come to this with honesty, care, and love, you will find your way. And to start with what Kim said, by asking us what films influence us, all of those things that we see, the warmth of a Mel Brooks in dealing with something difficult, the artistic and challenging and provocative style of a Herzog, the beauty of a Chaplin, I mean, that just
Thank
motivates
you.
And moves. I mean, all of those things, yeah. not
there,
necessarily
there are,
documentary,
there are many
but
ways,
imbue
usually.
Our work.
Yeah. Or, there's no one right answer. There's some
another,
wrong ways,
another,
but there are many right ways.
Another way to put it, I think if you had 12 people setting out to make a film about the same topic,
mm-hmm. be very different.
They'd be completely
yeah.
different.
Yeah.
So the subtlety of the of filmmaking, it's very hard to communicate what it is, but it's just the combination of mm-hmm. of all the things that lead to the film, all the relationships and all the preferences and all the things you like. So that's what makes it a film.
Yeah. Does that sort of answer not yeah. your question?
I hear more about how do you capture that internal thing that's the creativity of an artist or somebody dealing with bipolar situations. It's because, you know, what Ryan was saying was how you as a filmmaker were making the movie, but how do you deal with the person that you're trying to get the information from?
Deal with them in terms of, like, how do you capture that somebody is an artist or somebody is dealing with bipolar disorder and what the distinctions are?
How you're trying to...
Well, I don't know you do research and you read about it, you think about it, you talk about what you're going to do, you watch other movies or get inspiration and you think about an approach. And if you're interviewing people, another thing that's not discussed is the art of the interview. Interviewing, it's not just mm-hmm. asking questions, it's a whole environment you're creating. And
to try to specifically yeah. answer on, you know, with somebody with bipolar, what's interesting is I think our, with Of Two Minds, with bipolar disorder, probably the most telling moments were the personal camera. Like we have somebody who's like, right now I'm feeling really, really manic. And she just starts dancing in front of the camera and she's doing this thing. And there were times when we were talking to her when she broke down and cried. She said, I am so depressed right now and I didn't want to cancel this interview, but this is what's going on. And she just went on. And she just went on. And that those are the true moments. Those are the honest moments. Because as much as I could tell you that I'm feeling really depressed right now, but I'm doing this panel and I'm doing this, and it's like you're not going to see it necessarily, but I'm telling you. And it's one thing to tell somebody. It's another thing to feel it and see it, and you have to kind of live and breathe it, if that makes sense, like as you're, you know, talking to people and really getting to know them, and hopefully there's an intimacy on the camera with that, you know, with these stories.
Other questions? Yes?
Yeah, I think it was Lisa who said that you don't get into documentaries to make money, and a lot of other people have said that as well. But obviously you have to eat and you have bills. So I was curious how you monetize your films from beginning to end, maybe through the grant process or however you initially acquire funds through distribution, and how you are able to then pay your bills, live your life, and then maybe acquire money for your next project.
You folks, start on this end.
Yeah, I mean, the French system is great.
Tell us about it.
They give money to filmmakers, and they do also in the U.S.
Because they think film is important.
Yeah, okay. There is a U.S. like, you know, film industry, and okay, there is every single smaller countries in the world that have to battle with. So it's true that is also an incentive to try to you know, help film industries exist in other countries that don't have the marketing power of the US. But the specificity about the French system is that it also particularly helps movies that would not exist. You know, even on the French market, some movies will not come out and make any money. But if you have something that is worth, you know, telling, a story that is worth telling, the French system will potentially give you money to tell that story, even if it's not a story that would make money, that wouldn't be a marketable story. So we're lucky we have access to that system, but frankly, a lot of countries have these kind of fundings, you know, the UK, Australia, I mean, it's, so many countries have that, Germany, Spain, Italy, it's just, hard to go through that process. It's very time demanding. French producers are known as the file makers, like they don't make movies, they make files to submit to grants. But I guess if you're trying to make a professional, you know, life out of making documentaries, it's kind of like you need to learn that, or you need to be teaming up with people who know how to do that, because like you asked, you gotta pay the bills, you gotta live, and if you don't have a healthy environment to make your work, it's going to be hard, especially with documentaries. So that's how we did. We got a grant from the French Film Commission. We did get some people involved, also the producers, and we were able to shoot the movie. We're not able to pay the bills. Like, I had to work on the side to pay my own bills.
What do you do on the side? Can you share?
I was a 3D filmmaker, and I was working for hire on other projects. But I would say it's like, you know, in this industry, whether it's documentary or even any other field in that industry, you got to be able to take the hit at the beginning and, you know, go through it. And to be honest, most often friends and family are helping you to get started, because sometimes you can't pay the bills, and you got to ask for some help.
John, how about you?
Both films that I made, I had success with Kickstarter, doing online, crowdsourcing. So, and that's how I always get started with the film, but it's never how I finish it, because it's you're out of money by the time before you even know it. And so, I've done as far as the crowdsourcing, I've also put a lot of my own money into the films. And the way that I support myself is kind of the same thing. Like, as far as I work, a lot of, New Orleans has a lot of commercials, so I do a lot of commercial work as a crew member. Like, as far as like either like as a camera operator or a camera assistant, I work a lot of sporting events. I mean, I do freelance work, and that really is. I mean, if I didn't have all that stuff, then I wouldn't be able to do the work. So, you know, I mean, I hope one day I can do nothing but work on documentaries, but like as far as like that, I don't know if that ever happened. You know, it's a tough road. So
you gotta love it.
Yeah, no, and it's great. I mean, it's a great road.
You do it because you love it. You do it because you have to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, you know, another thing too, which is like something that's come up a lot recently, is I've started doing smaller branding documentaries for companies and things like that. And that there's something really nice about that, because it leans more toward the documentary stuff. And it's also a lot quicker of a process, and there's actually a paycheck at the end of it. So, yeah. But yeah, you're right. Like, as far as like you do it because you love it. Yeah.
Anyone else want to chime in? monetizing your film?
Well, I think one theme is that the market itself is not going to support the creation of every film. And so people want to make films, and so you can just make your film. We do commercial films, and like we're sort of commissioned to make a film, like you were saying, for a business or a nonprofit organization. And so that's what we do. And there's always a synergy between whatever you're doing. You know, you get to use a piece of equipment on one project, you can use it on your film. Mm-hmm. It allows you time to think about it. So you just have to make it work. I once got really good advice one day from somebody who said, you know, you might do one job and it might take you a week and you might get paid a lot. You might do another job that might take 6 months and you'll get paid less. You might do a job that you pay for yourself. But taken as a whole, that's kind of your career.
Right, yeah.
And they all kind of help one another, and so you just have to make it work.
Yeah. I mean, the monetization thing, I mean, the truth be told, for all the things that have changed in the industry, the new platforms and the new opportunities are not much different than what the original platforms are. You know, Netflix is the new video store. The new CBS is Amazon Prime. The new Fox is this channel. I mean, literally, all they've done, all that's happened is a little bit of a shift. And there's certainly more opportunities, but there's also more content. And that's where intern research and your savvy and your ability to find ways to meld the old with the new, and you will create and find a way. I keep going back to Up Two Minds because I work closely with Lisa and Doug on their film in creating panel discussions, in creating connections with outreach organizations. When Doug came to Toronto with the film, we did tons of press, but we had to reach out to those groups and those organizations and those panelists. And by going to those people, we were able to get those specific people that were interested in that topic. And finding artists, finding people who are passionate about a social issue, about justice, about the things that you care about, not everybody wants to see your film. Not everybody wants to talk about it. And I remember when Matthew Shepard's parents, whom I love, said to me, and bluntly, and they were honest about it, not everybody wants to go out on a Friday night and see the film about a dead gay kid. And that's their own son. And he said, I know that sounds blunt, but that's what somebody who doesn't know their pain and their story thinks. So you have to be aware of, with your documentary, and because we are on a topic here with documentary, that where your audience is, how you're going to monetize it. Is that going to be educational? Is that going to be doing event screenings? Is there a way to take a film that deals specifically to like people who are circus performers? Well, there's circus schools and there's events. Or if there's a film about a sporting event, there's films about... Everything you do has got to be about, one, your research, two, your knowledge of how other platforms have worked in the past, and three, what the new platforms are. When you think of all of that, you will come together with a complete plan that will work for you and will give you the best opportunity to monetize. And it's not going to necessarily be millions of dollars, but it might be enough to just pay the bills to get to that next story. And that's what we're all hoping to do.
Are there other questions? Garrett?
How do you go about finding music for your films, and do you have to be extra careful in documentary because of the power of music to manipulate or change truth or reality, whatever you're trying to get at with documentary? Is there extra care taken when putting music to documentary?
Well, if anybody's ever done Kickstarter before, these composers come out of the woodwork. I don't know if you've had that experience.
Yeah.
It's like, I worked on a film when I was 7. and so that's a scary, I think the less money you have, the harder it is, only because then you're dealing with a lot of people. But, you know, it's sort of finding, but with any film, yeah, you have to be careful of manipulating, or, like, we're doing a film on suicide. I don't want, that's like
suicide
the worst.
Suicide is painless?
Suicide is painless, yeah. I mean, some of the stuff that, although there is, I'll tell you about it, there's a ukulele version of it that's really interesting, I don't know enough to know if it's any different from anything else. I only know just, you know, from documentary wise, it's just for us, it's just to, when you're dealing with some topic that can be perceived as heavy, that's the last thing that you want to do. So you, and when somebody comes in and says, I have perfect music for your documentary, a lot of times it might be Suicide is Painless or organ music or something like that. So you have to be careful, and it's like, no, I want it lighter, and then suddenly it's circus music. So yeah, you have to know enough about what you want to do, and you have to hope. It's like any relationship, you know, it's speed dating. You know, you have to be able to really get them to understand what you're doing and what your vision is for the film, I think.
Great thoughts. Anyone else want to chime in on the role of music, especially in documentary?
I mean, the types of documentaries I like, I prefer stuff without a lot of music, but I've utilized music in my own art in my documentary. If I'm doing a scene, in the new film Nora Through the Years, I had a scene where I was talking about what it was like to be in the gay community in the 70s. So she was talking about going to disco clubs. So what did I do? I pumped in some 70s disco vibe behind it, because I was talking about going to clubs, and she was talking about doing drugs and marching in parades and dancing and all of that. And then I cut to we got into going through the 70s into the 80s. And we were talking about the HIV AIDS epidemic and her being a care person. So I had to change the tone of that very quickly. I did use music, but I used something very, very silent and very just like bam, very just gentle. And I had shots of her on the water reflecting. So I wanted to give it that, again, that gentle quality that it needed. And sometimes that gentle quality is just no music at all. If you have a chance, it's one of the most beautiful films of the last, I'd say, decade, is a film called We Were Here, about the AIDS years in San Francisco. And in that 90-minute film, there is about 8 minutes of music. That's it.
Yeah. And it's overused.
It's very, 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 very there's not a lot of music in We Were Here, and it...
Music is overused, Philip?
Well, just in general, I think it can be overused. And a lot of times you do watch films and they just have kind of wall-to-wall music. And it's extremely powerful music. You know, you can take the same piece of... Obviously, you take the same footage and you can play it different music, and it is completely different. So you can try that at home. But, so you have to be very aware of that. And it shouldn't be just something that you do... because you need it. It should be something that you choose to put in there carefully, I think.
Yeah.
Other questions? Jordan?
You kept talking about trust. Have you ever had the experience of one of your subjects or colleagues see the final film and say, how could you do that to me? Or that you destroyed the trust I thought we had going?
John?
I think that, it goes back to how you find people that you're going to interview, as far as like the people that, like, just through research, everybody that I've ever interviewed is people that are more than happy to share their story, like, as far as that they want to. And then while we're in the edit process, one of the things that I always take into account or I think about is that, would this person be okay with the way that I'm portraying them? Because I think the last thing that you'd ever want to do is to put someone's life out there on the screen that has put trust in you, and for them to feel exploited. So there's been things, you know, especially if you have access to people that you really do get a lot of the story, and oftentimes you'll see things, or you've been recorded things to where you know for a fact that they probably don't want this to be a part of their story. They're not comfortable with this being out in the world. And You know, and so, you know, I definitely take that into account. And then just to be safe, you know, before I ever do any kind of public exhibition of the films, I'll always show it to the people, like as far as like to get there, to see if there's anything in there that they don't want. Yeah.
You gotta do that. You gotta do that, particularly if you're talking about something intimate like guns or mental illness or something like that. Because then you can definitely.
Can I post it to Arno too? Because your film is a little different than the others.
I was gonna say the same thing with the artists. I mean, they, you know, when they do a piece of work, they're pretty much bringing themselves into it. So it's also talking about their own, you know, like intimacy and their own like, you know, like soul. So. We did show the movie to the artists that are depicted into the movie, and I didn't have to have their permission because we had all the artists sign a document before you know, giving us permission to be documentaries documentary filmmakers, which means, you know, we could have done what we wanted, but I did show it to them and I wanted to get their feedback, and none of them had anything, you know.
Were they excited or?
Yeah, I mean, some of them were quiet, and I could tell that maybe some of them were holding back. And, you know, I did ask to these people, you know, a few times, is there anything you would like to tell me? But they all, you know, let us do a movie.
That's great.
Well, there is another difficulty in this, in that if you're making a film, say, with a very controversial issue, where there's two very specific positions. There's films on white supremacists, there's films on hate, there's films on political issues, that sometimes you have to think about the topic, and we all take a position. I mean, because, you know, all documentary is subjective. I mean, we're editing. I mean, so, you know, nothing's just in that sense. But the idea is if you're doing a topic on something and you're trying to do a topic about why it's wrong to be a racist, and we all know why it's wrong, but there are people who think that it's completely right, and they're going to see some horrible, hateful things, and they may be upset at the end that you made me look worse than I am. Well, you said those things, and the idea is how do you, you know, you don't want to make somebody feel like completely look like the boogeyman unless they really are, and in some cases they really are. So that's a tough, you know, moral thing to think about as well, is like, am I really imbuing this with too much negativity? And how do you get the story across? But sometimes you can't avoid it. Sometimes you really have to say no, because you know morally where you stand and what's right, and you have to kind of present it. But you also have to present it in a way that people can kind of, I still think, see some level of what that other person's thinking. And the best documentaries that explore those topics give you a little bit of an uncomfortable position where you don't necessarily want to go into their mind, but if you can get a little glimpse into that person, it gives you some sense of humanity into a really dark space.
Thank you. Just one more question, the student question. Asia.
I was just gonna ask, like, how do you go about finding your topics? Like, are they brought to you? Are there things that you've always wanted to research? Like, how do you go about finding these?
Well, for me, it's just, it's weird. I mean, calling myself a documentary filmmaker is great, but I'm all about the passion of what it is. Like, for example, my sister had bipolar disorder. So for me, it's incredibly internal. So it's whatever's driving me, with the exception of the one that's at the festival, because that, which would answer your question, was what funded or helped, but that was a work for hire. And we did it solely, not that I didn't believe in raising awareness on PBA, but like suicide, which is something that's in my family, I really needed to do this film. And it wasn't like people were coming to me, yeah, here's money, we're raining down on that. So we did that film to do that. But so it's, for me, it's passion.
Yeah, let's get a quick answer from each of you, because I think that's an important question. What?
Well, they come all different ways. It might be you're hired to do something, or it might be you have an opportunity because you know someone to do something. But as a student, I would just say do what interests you. Find a story or a person or a place that you know that interests you.
Something that's
and you tell your own, you find your own dramatic arc, you know, if you will, in that, whatever it is.
Can I ask Arno where Burning Man come from for you?
No, it has to be close to you. I mean, I've been like very close to several Burning Man artists for years and years and years, and if you don't have a personal connection to it, I mean, you know, you could be a very good researcher, and if it's a work for hire, you could do a good job, but there will never be anything that would come close to, you know, like a work of passion.
I guess both my films come from, as far as like hearing personal stories that of injustice that moved me enough to think that other people need to be aware of it. You know, and with the last film, and I still kind of think this is true, is that if you don't think that it's worth spending like 3 years of your life doing nothing but that, right, then walk away from it.
Right.
I mean, and people will approach you all the time saying, "Hey, you should do this film, and it sounds like
right.
a great idea." But if you don't,
yeah.
don't
yeah.
do it.
Right.
Yeah.
It has to be your
right.
Yeah.
If you're doing a feature film, that's so true. You will be sitting in an editing room in 3 years,
mm-hmm.
even though you don't think you will. You will be. So you have to.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, 3 years if you're lucky.
Yeah.
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 Yep. Living and breathing.
Well, yeah, and we're getting going on some interesting topics here. Thank you all. I think we're out of time.
Yeah.
John,
I just need for sure to grab John. Anyone
okay.
else? We have shuttles waiting, but John is.
If anybody wants to see my film, it's playing at 4:00. Today at the
right.
film festival.
Was he in the film?
So.
He was
on.
He was
right.
a year
well,
with
okay,
him.
Okay, bye, John.
All right, bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.